Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Noya. And good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us this morning. I appreciate it. Let's get started with strategy-driven innovation. The idea that I want to begin with is the one that markets are constantly changing, which I think most of you probably are finding. Rivals are shifting, and whether your business is going up or going down, you're probably often asking yourself, what's our strategy? Do we have the right one? Is it going to be a winner in the future? The answer is often a buffet. You have a strategic plan, maybe you're looking at your position, maybe you're thinking about your core competences, maybe you have a binder from a consulting company from somewhere. In other words, there are a lot of answers to the question, what's our strategy? But in dynamic markets, what the course on strategy-driven innovation is focusing on is strategy in dynamic markets, when products are changing, when rivals are shifting, and when you're not quite sure what's going to happen in the future. There are three key ideas in that kind of strategy. Strategy is simple, strategy is about time, and strategy is about the edge of chaos. To give you a bit of a graphic, here's a picture of what strategy looks like over time. The key insight is that strategy in dynamic markets is not operating in one time frame, not even two, but in three. Today, the short term, and the long term. What we're going to be doing in the webinar this morning is focusing in on that first time frame, real time, simple rules and metrics. And in particular, what we're going to be doing is focusing in on business strategy as simple rules. The metaphor of business strategy as simple rules is a simple one. It's the idea of the world has a lot of opportunities in a dynamic market, and what you're trying to do is be the surfer who catches the great wave. So you're catching the flow of opportunities, and you're trying to do it sooner, faster, and better than rivals. In other words, again, catch the wave. What's your strategy to do that? Strategy is focusing on one or two or three key strategic processes. It might be product innovation, it might be acquisitions, it might be something in purchasing. Focusing on a key process and a few simple rules. Pixar, the animation studio that brought you Ratatouille, Brave, Bug's Life, Toy Story, and so on, is a great example of a company that's using a lot of simple rules, particularly for their movie-making process. For example, no studio executives. Great story before great animation. One movie a year. And then you go. What I think I want to concentrate on today, because that's what we're going to cover in the course, but today what I want to focus on is some of the secret sauce that's over there in the organization. There are two pieces of the secret sauce. One is the business teams are incredibly important to whether or not a strategy is successful. And the second is that the best teams are able to make fast decisions. And that's really going to be, and that's why it's in bold today, is what our focus is going to be on today. How do teams make fast decisions? That's incredibly important in the context of dynamic markets and when you're trying to make strategy as simple rules. What's the imperative? The imperative is what this, I guess, I'm not quite sure what shape that is, but that blue thing is. The only constant is everything is changing. We have to take advantage of change. We have to be ahead of the game, otherwise we miss the window. So that's really the imperative of the need for speed in dynamic markets. The question for today is, how do you actually get speed? How do you make a fast decision? Well, there are a lot of possibilities that come to mind. Cut back on the number of alternatives. Don't look at much information. Cut back on expertise and just go for it. Alternatively, just pull people out of it. Concentrate on power, limit participation, do it yourself. Don't get involved in conflict. Another idea is, well, you know, let's continue to eliminate this decision-dragging conflict. We're concentrating power. Let's just only have people who are more or less on the same page with us. The problem is that those strategies, while they seem like they're going to work, be less thorough, have less people, have less conflict, but they don't answer two important questions. How do you actually overcome the anxiety to make a fast choice? It turns out that in real life, fast decision-making is about, to some extent anyway, procrastination and overcoming anxiety. How do you get the gumption to make the call? The other issue is how do you make a smart choice? Anybody can make a fast choice. You can roll a dice, you can throw a dart, but how do you actually make a choice that's fast but also high quality? What we're going to be doing this morning is talking about a couple of different ways to make fast decisions. In fact, we're going to look at five principles that we've developed out of some of the research we've been doing with a variety of companies that have to move in fast markets, and figuring out both from the companies that could move quickly and the companies that couldn't and the teams that could and the teams that couldn't, what are the principles of fast decision making? That's our focus. So five principles, here we go. Here's number one. One of the myths of fast decision making is this less information. Just cut back on the information. Don't use very many experts. Don't do a lot of analysis. Just go for it. That's certainly what we see, actually, the slow decision makers, or fast decision makers who do a bad job. That's what they do. In contrast, what do great fast decision makers do? The most successful fast decision makers are actually using more information, not less. But the key is that that information is real-time information, focused on internal operations and external markets, not a lot of plans and not a lot of pie in the sky. Let me give you a couple of examples of that. One of them is a company that we call Zap. This is a small entrepreneurial company. The team at Zap meets every week. They obviously see each other more than that or are online with each other. And they track on a daily basis, at least some of the team does, daily bookings. Each of the VPs also has an assignment. One, the R&D VP, is charged with understanding the grapevine of what's going on in technology. The VP of marketing is focused in on what rivals are doing. VP of sales is looking at what customers are doing. VP of finance has a weekly model that she runs to see what's going on with the operating margins of the company. In other words, they're constantly looking at real-time information. When they get together for their weekly meeting, whether it's on Skype or live, each person is charged with their particular area of information. And then they do a monthly full-scale review of a variety of measures, from operating margins to manufacturing yield to so on. Another company is a company we call Triumph, or another team is a number we call Triumph. Here the boss of the team is known as a quantitative guy. The decision that we looked at for this particular team was one looking at product development projects. This team tracks product development projects on an almost daily basis, knowing exactly what's going on in every project. Weekly staff meetings are a must. Nobody misses those. In contrast, what are the slow decision makers doing? One of them, for example, one of the teams that we talked to, the general manager, spoke about how he was interested in subjective values, that certainly he cared about information and quantitative and the numbers and all that, but he was really also interested in integrity. Fortunately, fast decision-making integrity are not antithetical, but this person's focus was pretty much only on subjective issues, big picture, slow decision-making. Couldn't really get anywhere. Finally, one of the CEOs that we looked at and one of the small companies that we studied, we got some descriptions of this person. This person leads a team that is making decisions quickly. What am I talking about when I mean making decisions quickly? I'm talking about making strategic decisions like developing a new product, going to a new market, introducing new features, expanding a branch, getting more money, doing that kind of a decision in 2 to 3 months. In contrast, slow decision makers take 6 to 8, 9, even a year to make the same kind of decision. The CEO of this small company we looked at called Zap was interesting because he really personified what fast decision makers look like. He's highly quantitative, but he's also known as intuitive and a lateral thinker. Which leads me to why is it that focusing on lots of information makes you a fast decision maker? One is when you're looking day after day, week after week, at quantitative information, whether it's sales numbers, whether it's operations numbers, whether it's what's going on in product innovation, you start to understand decisions more quickly than other people. You start to be able to see opportunities for choices, problems coming up over the horizon before other people see it. So you see things sooner when you stay in touch with information. The second thing, when you're in touch with information, you're constantly looking at information about, not about your finances of last month, but what's happening now with your sales force, what's happening right now with your marketing team, is it starts to build intuition. Looking day after day after day at information starts to develop patterns and intuition. It's like playing a video game. There's not really a strategy in video games. You just play, and as you play, you develop intuition. Finally, why is real-time information fast? Because if you look at real-time information together as a team, whether real or virtually, but doing that together, looking at what's going on in the various aspects of your business, let's say it's logistics or whatever it is, you start to develop a kind of teamwork where you know one person is in charge of one set of questions, another person is in charge of another, another person is set in charge of another set. You start to develop teamwork that lets you act quickly. So maybe to summarize, real-time information, as one of our better teams told us, we have a very strong information, we over-aviate around here, we measure everything. So that's step number one. Instead of limiting your information, use more information and make it real-time. Second idea. One of the myths of fast decision-making is that you avoid a lot of alternatives. You pick pretty quickly what you think is going to be the winning alternative, analyze it. If it doesn't work out, move on. But you're always focusing on one and analyzing it. In contrast, that's not what fast decision-makers do. That's what slow decision-makers do. What do fast decision-makers do? They consider more alternatives, not less. They typically look in any particular major decision at 3 to 5 alternatives. Another key of what they're doing is time. They don't look at alternatives sequentially. They look at them at the same time. So you're contrasting 3, 4, 5 alternatives. Let me give you an example. One of the teams we were looking at was considering an alliance decision, tying up with another company and trying to use that as a way to leverage some of their own resources and get some new resources. They considered a variety of alternatives, different kinds of partners, large company partners, small company partners, partners that were directly related to them in terms of being rivals, partners that were also complementers, trying to figure out what was the way to go. The team considered 3 to 5 alternatives at the same time and came up with one in a relatively quick period of time. Another one was a company that we called Triumph. This was a company, actually a team, where the strategic decision was, do we need a new strategy? The team's product wasn't selling very well, and they were trying to see what was the best thing to do. Do we need a new strategy? Do we need a new product? Do we need a new marketing campaign? Do we need a technology sale? What do we need? The team came up with multiple different strategies, and as one of the team members told us in describing her boss, he likes to have a lot of options on the table. He's great with ambiguity. He likes to be able to see what's going on and compare quickly. Another interesting team was a team we'll call Promise. Promise is in the consumer marketing business. What was interesting about Promise was in the decision that we talked about with them, it was a product positioning decision. There was an immediate alternative that was pretty obvious. But rather than going with that alternative, the team decided to develop what they called fake alternatives. As they told us, we have a sincere alternative, but we also have fake alternatives. We use those fake alternatives to explore the crevices of what our opportunities are. In contrast, the slow decision makers typically looked at one alternative. A great example is a team that we called Alpha. It was a new product decision is what our focus was. They focused for a while on one alternative, what the features of that new product could be. It took about 6 months analyzing that, looking at market data and so forth. Finally coming up with the idea that, you know, maybe that actually isn't going to be right, especially when the marketing VP said, no way, we're not going there. Then they moved to a second alternative. Another couple of months later, took them to finally make the call. In that final call, the CEO actually worked alone, and everybody opposed it, and finally they ended up with a third alternative that was, in fact, not very well thought out. Another company was a company we called Nupron. This was a small company. They were looking at an alliance decision. They delayed and delayed and delayed and were finally forced into an alternative that didn't really work for them. Overall, why are multiple alternatives smart and why are alternatives fast? One is, and I think this is kind of an interesting point, is it's actually harder to analyze an alternative by itself. It turns out it's much quicker to analyze alternatives in comparison. Think of it when you go to buy a new car or you go to buy a new outfit. You walk in. Do you buy the first car that you see? Do you buy the first dress that you see? No. Typically, you have to shop. And as you look at the alternatives, as you start to see multiple cars or multiple outfits, you start to realize the features that you care about. And so it actually turns out that it's cognitively faster to analyze in comparison rather than isolation. The other reason why multiple alternatives are smart is it reduces escalation of commitment to any one alternative. What does that mean? That means if you choose too soon an alternative and focus on only one, it starts to become your baby, and it starts to become an alternative that's hard to give up. In contrast, if you have several alternatives, sure, you may have a favorite, but you also probably have a number two that you could go with, and number three you could live with in a pinch. Which brings me to another reason why multiple alternatives are fast. They create a fallback position. You thought multiple alternative one was going to be the winner, but look, it doesn't work, but you can quickly go to number two or number three, and you've already thought about them. You already know their strengths and weaknesses. Finally, one of the reasons why multiple alternatives works, which I didn't put on the slide, but which I'll tell you, is it's politically popular. One alternative tends to polarize groups. You either like it or you don't. In contrast, when there are multiple alternatives, it lets people have gray positions and make compromise a lot easier. So to summarize, multiple alternatives, as one of our team members on a fast team told us, we always generate multiple options. It's better if you can work a multiple array of possibilities instead of just a couple. Okay, let's go to our third. Our third is two-tier advice. The previous two ideas, real-time information and multiple alternatives, are largely fast because they're cognitively fast. Two-tier advice is fast because it's politically fast. What are the myths? The myths are you speed up decision-making by centralizing power, do it yourself. Limit participation and go for it. That, as it turns out, is what the slow decision-makers do, or at least many of the slow decision-makers do. In contrast, what's best practice? Seek counsel from a variety of people on your team, and even your colleagues and peers, but always have one or two experienced counselors that you turn to for special advice and to act as a sounding board. A great example is one of our teams where the decision was on a new sales channel. As it turned out, the leader of the team had as his counselor his VP of sales. As the team leader described the interaction, the sales guy, it's more than interaction about sales with him. We talk about everything. We talk about all parts of the business, and I can trust him implicitly. In the decision that we looked at, in fact, this particular sales exec did alert the team leader to the problems that a rival was about to present. The team leader and the sales executive worked together, sounding board ideas, and of course they went out and talked to the rest of the team, but the team leader was able to get to the issues quickly by using this trusted counselor. One of the things that we saw across looking at a variety of teams and fast decisions is that the counselors had a particular demographic profile. That person was typically 10, maybe even 20 years older than the rest of the team. Typically was a person who'd seen a lot, done a lot, wasn't their first rodeo, as they say, and who often saw him or herself as at a plateau. As one of the experienced counselors told us, you know, I'm not really in it for the money anymore. It's all about building a great organization. Another example was one of our teams that I referred to before, the ZAP team. Here, the team leader used two counselors. One was 10 years older, one was 20 years older. One was a sales exec with years of experience at multiple firms. The other was a VP of engineering who had worked for a long time with one of the leading companies in the industry. These two executives were key sounding boards for our team leader. What do you do if you don't have a person that fits that demographic? That happened in one of our teams, too. In that case, what the team leader did was actually hire a consultant, and that consultant fit the demographic. Older, experienced, not out for his or herself. That consultant ended up doing the job of sounding board, not only for the team leader, but several other team members, and made some significant contributions in the decision that we focused on. In contrast, what do the slow decision makers do? They either don't have a counselor and simply go on their own, team leaders or team members, or the team leader is using the wrong kind of a person. An example is a team I'm going to call Omicron. Here the counselor was 32, described as bright, energetic, super future. But that counselor, she was smart, and she was all of those things, but she was also young and didn't have the experience. She was also still out for her own agenda. No worries there, no blame there. Most of us were in that point of our career. We are looking out for ourselves as well as for our team and our company. But it also gets in the way of being a sounding board. Lack of experience, lack of right agenda. Overall, what's the point? The point is fast decision makers use a two-tier advice process. They get advice broadly. If they're leaders of a team, they ask the entire team, involve the entire team. But they always have as a sounding board, off to the side, one or two experienced counselors. Why does this work? Why does two-tier advice work? Why does it make you fast? You get a broad range of ideas, obviously, from consulting a wide variety of people. But you also get ideas from counselors who are particularly quick at coming up with ideas. They've seen a lot. Their ideas are typically high quality, and you can trust them. You can bounce off your own ideas with them and know that it's not going to go further. Finally, what counselors do, and this is something not to forget, counselors give you confidence. And one of the reasons why people can't make fast choices is oftentimes not that they don't know what to do, but because they have a lot of anxiety about doing it. In contrast, counselors, to use a popular phrase, it's not their first rodeo. They've seen it before. They can give you the confidence to make the call. Let's go to number four. Well, before we do that, let's also remember what an experienced counselor is. As one of our team leaders said, I talk a lot with the strongest managers. I talk with Lori, who knows the outside world, and I talk with Tim. He's our best manager. Okay, number four. One of the myths of fast decision-making is that it's all about reducing conflict. Cut back conflict, you can decide quickly. And don't worry about conflict resolution, just decide. In contrast, it turns out that in real life, that the amount of conflict actually doesn't really influence how fast the decision-making is. Sometimes it's fast, sometimes it's slow. The key is not the amount of conflict, the key is how you resolve it. What's best practice? Best practice is try for consensus, try to get everybody on board, but if consensus doesn't happen, you do what we call consensus with qualification. If consensus doesn't happen, then make the call. Either you as team leader make the call, or the person most engaged with the decision makes the call, or maybe you even vote, but you have some way that people expect the call is going to get made. I'll give you an example. Here's one of our teams. There's a lot of conflict about new product. What's our new product? Is it going to be a product with a certain set of features? Are we simply going to tune up the old product? Are we going to revamp fully into a new product? There was a lot of talk, a lot of divergence. Some people said new product diverts too many resources. Other people, particularly in the marketing and sales side, not surprisingly, said it's a must-have. We've got to have that new product. They talked about it. It was clear there was going to be no decision made. The team was never going to agree. And that's okay. I think you have to expect that on certain dynamic markets, smart people aren't always going to be agreeing. But what this team did was, when consensus wasn't going to happen, the CEO of the small team pulled the trigger, made the call. In contrast, conflict is a real problem on a slow team. One of our teams, we'll call it presidential, was also faced with a decision around figuring out an alliance partner. Presidential folks talked for days, talked for weeks. In fact, they talked for months. The decision stretched on and on for about 6 months. The only way they got to a decision was because one of the people who objected to what the majority of the people wanted to do actually left the company. Another problem with the slow decision makers is they wait for deadlines. They sort of discuss. Finally, they hit a deadline. Maybe it's a board meeting. Maybe it's an annual meeting. Some sort of a deadline. They've got to make a call, and then they choose. But if the deadline never happens, they never choose. Another interesting thing that happens to deadlines that we've seen is that oftentimes people, when they have a deadline and they can't get consensus, will come right up to the deadline and then suddenly choose an alternative they've hardly thought about at all. In other words, they'll make a snap decision. They'll have thought about alternative A, debated it. It's not working. And then finally the team leader says, all right, forget it, we're going to B. And that, I think, as you can imagine, is probably not a very smart way to make a decision. Overall, why is consensus with qualification, that is trying for consensus, but if you don't get it, have a way to make the call, the team leader, person most in charge, or even vote, why does consensus with qualification work? First of all, it copes directly with a conflict inherent in most important decisions. In real life, important decisions in uncertain markets, you're almost always going to have people who don't agree. And so by having consensus with qualification, it recognizes that you're the reality of that situation. The other thing that's smart about it is that it avoids waiting for outside events. You don't delay and delay and delay until a rival makes a move and you have to make a call. You don't delay and delay and delay until you're having a board meeting and you can't look dumb in front of your board members. So it avoids waiting for an outside event. Finally, and I think probably the most important reason, why does consensus qualification work well? people like it. People like consensus up to a point, and after that, they just wish somebody would decide because they're so tired of talking about it. In contrast, consensus with qualification is popular because what most people want is not necessarily every decision to go their way, but rather to have their input heard. Consensus with qualification does that. At the same time, what most people want is also to be able to make the call when it's most important to them. So if it's an engineering decision, engineering folks really do want to make that call. They're more willing to maybe let a marketing decision slip. And so this method typically has the people most for whom the decision is most important and who are most involved making the call. So to summarize, consensus with qualification works because it copes with conflict, doesn't have you waiting for deadlines that may never happen, and people like it. To summarize, as one team member said, our process is very open. We're successful most of the time in building consensus. Otherwise, BJ, who is the team leader, he makes the call. Final point is decision integration. One of the interesting things about fast decision making is that it turns out that people are quicker when they actually put several decisions together at once. But let me just touch on the myths. One of the myths is that you can make a faster decision by starting with a blank slate and just focusing on one decision at a time. Let's make our engineering decision, then we'll go to our manufacturing decision, then we'll go to our logistics decision, then we'll go to our website decision and do it that way. In fact, that tends to be a slow way to decide, a slow way as well as an ineffective way. In contrast, what's best practice? Best practice is about integrating the current decision with what you're going to do in the future and what you've done in the past. It also involves tying in with tactics like budgeting plan and perhaps product releases. It also involves having a worst case backup just in case the plan that you come up with is not going to work. Here's an example of a new product development decision. This was a decision that was made in about 3 months of whether or not to develop a new product. The team decided, yes, we're going to do a new product, and moreover, integrated as they were making that decision, integrated that decision with tactics like product release schedule and budgeting, and also integrated that with a fallback position on a different technical option if the first technical option didn't play out. Another company had also developing a, this was an alliance decision and developing with a major partner. This decision began with a new team leader coming on board. This team leader pushed the team to develop multiple alternatives. And then as they started to analyze each of those alternatives and started to come up with a favorite alternative, started to tie that alternative in with cash flow planning problems so that they had a short-term decision on the marketing partner. They also had a backup marketing partner. They had a long-term game plan for the first partner, but also the second and third, and they developed some key details around the must-haves in the deal with that partner. Did all this in about 3 or 4 months. In contrast, what do the slow decision makers do? They tend to keep decisions in the abstract. Thinking about a new product? Think about whether we need a new product or not. Say yes, no, and then we go into the issues around releases, staffing, and so forth. In fact, we had an interesting contrast in our study. We looked at one team where it was a product development decision. Another team that I just talked about before, same decision. The slow team, 6 months, and all they really got accomplished was, yes, we need a new product. In contrast, the fast team, in 3 months, got the decision, yes, we need a new product, but also had the budget, a fallback position, and rollout plans. Why is decision integration fast? First of all, I think one of the interesting things about integrating decisions with tactics and other decisions is that it speeds the analysis of alternatives. As you decide and that you have to then tie that into tactics and other decisions, you start to see both the strengths and weaknesses of your focal decision. Sure, we're going to have this new product, but as we tie it into a marketing plan, wait a minute, we realize it's actually not going to work, for example. The second thing that it does, and this is a related point, is that when you tie a single decision with other decisions, it creates a more concrete understanding of that decision, of the engineering resources that we might need, of the web team resources that we might need. Third, it builds a sense of confidence and control that the decision is going to be successful. You've got a sense that you've thought about the different alternatives. You've put the decision together, and you get a sense that, yes, we've got it under control. We know what we're doing. It's going to work. This doesn't mean that you've got some big plan of how everything fits together. This is much more back of the envelope. Can you sit at a meeting and can you sketch on the back of the envelope or on your new iPad what the decision is going to look like and how it's going to integrate? It's quick. It's can you do it in 10, 15, 20 minutes, get a rough outline of how it all fits. To summarize, we try to think about how an alternative would sync up with what we're doing broadly and how it also will work in terms of staffing and products. As you can see from this quote, it's about any alternative you're thinking about the big decision of what we're doing more broadly, but we're also looking about how it works in terms of tactics. So to summarize, where are we? Fast decision making. Make fast decisions and make fast decisions that are smart. Look for real-time information. Focus on multiple alternatives. Be sure you're gathering advice broadly, but develop an experienced counselor. Traffic consensus, but if you can't do it, have a way to make the call. And integrate any decision with other decisions and tactical plans in a back of an envelope kind of way. Why is this fast? It accelerates cognitive processing, accelerates how you think. So for example, if you consider real-time information, if you keep looking day after day at the same real-time information, you build intuition, which is fast. Look at multiple alternatives. Comparison, deciding in comparison is faster. It's faster to understand your alternatives in comparison. This process is fast because it's politically smart. For example, consensus with qualification involves everybody, which is what they want. People involves everybody, especially when it's what they care about most, but you still have a way to make the call. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, and what people forget about fast decision making, is it gives you the confidence. These tactics give you the confidence to act. The counselor, for example, gives you somebody to have as a sounding board who's been there before. Multiple alternatives gives you the sense that you really have explored what you could do. Integration gives you a sense that you really can do it. Why does speed matter? Turns out that speed doesn't matter if you're in a slow industry. Might be the case that speed doesn't matter if you're in the concrete industry. But if you're in an industry, whether it's IT, whether it's biotech, whether it's consumer marketing, whether it's banking, whatever it is, most industries these days are dynamic and speed matters. The faster you go, the more you learn because you make decisions and you see whether they work or not, and they let you also capture opportunities sooner, faster, and better than your rivals. To sum up, one executive told us, you have to keep up with the train. So to go back to where we started, what I tried to do today was talk a bit about that first box, real-time strategy, strategy for now. In the course, we go to two other time frames, real-time, short-term, and long-term. But for today, we focused on real-time, and we focused in on one of the secret sauces for making simple rules work, and that's fast decision-making by a team that's experienced at doing it. Thanks a lot, and let's move on to the next part of the webinar.
So my first question, Kathy, that I heard is, in fast decision-making, is it the quantity of information or the ability to recognize patterns that's critical?
Let's see. The question is around quantity of information versus patterns in fast decisions. I think they're actually what they are, Clarissa and the audience, is they're related. People develop intuition from patterns, and they develop intuition and patterns from information. So it's looking day after day, week after week, at whatever the key metrics are in your business. They may be web traffic. They may be something about eyeballs. They may be something in marketing. What they are depends on what your business is. But as you look at those, which is a lot of information, but you start to look at it, and that's really where the patterns come from. There's some interesting studies about playing chess. People become pattern recognized. What makes experts in chess better than you and me is they've played a lot of games and they are actually seeing the board as patterns. And so lots of information is what creates patterns.
Ah, so it's both, really.
So it's both. That's right.
So another question we had from the audience is a risk of seeking consensus groupthink?
It is, if you keep seeking consensus and you never pull the trigger, you never make the call, you're right. people either fall into groupthink or a bunch of people just become apathetic and don't want to play anymore. Now, what's really going on in terms of seeking consensus, and one of the critical ideas I was trying to convey is, sure, you try to get consensus, but if it's not there, you don't push for it. You know, it's over, it's not going to happen, and you have a way to choose. Moreover, tactics like multiple alternatives are actually ways to break up groupthink, because what you're trying to develop with multiple alternatives is three or four, maybe five alternatives, one you love, somebody else doesn't like, another you can live with, another one you can live with, other people have different ones that they can live with. So multiple alternatives, for example, is a way that you actually break up groupthink. So push for consensus. Don't go to groupthink. This isn't really about groupthink, and I don't think it's actually that much of a risk if you follow the ideas.
Great. So now, let's say you have a new team, and it doesn't have an agreed-upon way to make the final call when there isn't consensus.
Well, that's a good question. What do you do with a new team? Most of the time, you don't actually have a team that's completely new, in which case you can fall back on whatever you were doing before. But if it is truly a new team, there are a couple of ways you can do it. Obviously, you can talk about it and come up with a call. Usually a team will have a team leader, and so the team leader can be the one who makes the call, and so you can just have a default situation like that. Another way to do it is start to divide responsibilities. You know, usually a team will have different kinds of people on it and are there for different reasons. So somebody who knows how to construct websites, somebody who knows about how to do web-based marketing, somebody who knows how to do other kinds of consumer marketing, people with different skills. So you may be able to also make the call based on their skills. But if the team's new, it's really kind of incumbent on the team leader to start to develop that sense of how to make the call and make the call probably at least in the short run.
Great. So is the culture of a company a major cause for lack of speed?
Now that's a really good question. Some companies, it's clear, have a culture that's slow. And it's typically a culture that's around analysis paralysis. It's typically a culture that's perhaps not about accountability. But I wouldn't say it's always culture. Sometimes there are differences across teams. In fact, we've seen that in some of the big companies we looked at. Some teams, and particularly some business units, are very quick. Others, not so much. Paternalism is often either associated with, not always associated with being slow, because sometimes paternalistic companies are highly autocratic and decisions can get made fast. What the problem with paternalistic companies often is that politics are deadly. And so you really get wrapped up with all kinds of politics so that as you walk into a decision situation, it's not just about the decision making, but it's about a whole underlying subtext of company politics. So to summarize, culture of a company can be a cause for lack of speed, but that doesn't mean that in your team and as a team leader, you can't change that in your own situation.
So are there any suggestions that you have to continue to develop the skill in decision making? And can it apply to the nonprofit world, for example?
I think there are a couple of ways to think about how to apply it. One of them is to really try to work on the real-time information and the multiple alternatives. You can really do that fairly quickly. You can also start developing that counselor fairly quickly. So you can really have a three-pronged attack. What are the key metrics? Let's start looking at them. As we face a critical decision point, let's be sure we're not looking at one alternative. Let's dream up two or three or four. And let's start developing a counselor, either somebody that's already on the team or maybe somebody you can use from the outside. So I think you can get going on all three of those things pretty quickly as a three-pronged approach, and then go on into consensus and qualification. You'll also, I think, find that decision integration is actually a lot easier to do than you might think. Sit down and just put on the back of an envelope how things fit together. I think you'll find it is both confidence-building and really pretty easy to do. How does it apply to the nonprofit world, higher education? Certainly, I think these ideas are really about speed in general. You can make fast decisions in your personal life using this. For example, you're trying to decide what to do. Your child has a problem at school, and you're trying to decide what to do. These ideas will work for you. I think what happens is that these ideas are particularly powerful in situations where speed matters. So sitting here at Stanford, I have to say speed doesn't matter that much, and we actually debate things endlessly, and even designing a new parking lot can take years. But we're also in a situation where, you know, we don't have to be that fast. It just drives us all crazy this way. But in real life, if you're in a situation where you've got to be fast, these strategies work.
So one final question. If you can share with us a little bit about your course and the certificate, is it mostly about short-term or long-term strategies?
Okay. The course is really about three time frames. In fact, that's one of the central ideas of the course, is that strategy isn't just about now, and I've to a large extent, the stuff about fast decision-making is about strategy today, strategy where you are now. Strategy in dynamic markets is not about just now. It's also about tomorrow, and it's even about the next day. In fact, one of the things that makes strategy different in dynamic markets is you really do have to be thinking about not today, not just today, not just tomorrow, but that third time horizon. Because strategy in dynamic markets is more like a movie. And when you're in a movie, the action is constantly going. You have to keep up with the pace. It's only in slow markets that you can focus on one time frame. So to answer the questions, what we'll be talking about in the course is strategy today, strategy tomorrow, and strategy on that following day. And how do you go through time?
Well, thank you so much, Kathy. We really appreciate you joining us today. I see a lot of great questions, and I also saw a lot of thank yous from the participants. So thank you from us, and thank you from the group. And I'd like to turn it back to Noya, who will make some closing remarks.
First of all, I want to thank all of you who sat in on this. I hope it gave you at least one good idea and was worth it. And again, I really appreciate your time with me.